So here we go. You guys nervous?
We're not nervous.
Excellent. No stress, yeah, right?
We were nervous for a second.
But not anymore, because you guys are made for the action, right?
We are.
There we go.
We're here for it.
So we are here with the lovely Emma and Mariusz.
Yes.
Ah, hi, Josh.
Did I nail that?
You did it, yeah.
Very cool Polish name. I actually Googled it before I got here because I really wanted to pronounce it correctly.
You do one of those, like, say, see how it goes, like when you're like, oh, Mariusz.
Yes.
It which is why, you.
That's why I asked you how to pronounce it, because I would rather hear from you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But yeah, I was practicing literally all night.
You did, you messaged me, you're like, how do you say your name? Yeah.
I really love voice notes, as you guys can tell.
We did.
That's really one of my things. So yeah. Thank you for joining me. Thank you for inviting me here. So we're at the WeWorks building.
One of the
properties. Pretty cool concept. It kind of reminds me of the Airbnb of office space.
Yes.
Kind of like how Uber is the, you know, the Airbnb of taxis,
mm-hmm.
and so on and so forth. So Emma and Mariusz have a dance and Pilates studio, and you guys are literally doing your passion every single day. What is that like?
Well, our experience is pretty unique because, well, we don't actually have a studio space, so what we're doing is doing rental space for Pilates around the city, and we teach at Rise by V downstairs, so it's part of WeWork.
Nice.
And what else do we do? We just do a million things. We also...
We rent in Brooklyn, we rent in Manhattan, and if we travel, we rent in LA, or if we travel to Miami, we rent in Miami, so we're not, like, based in one spot. We're not limited to that.
That's awesome. So you're covering your bases globally.
Yes.
Have you guys ever done anything abroad?
Yes.
Yes. I taught dance abroad in Poland, because I'm from Poland, so I went back to my hometown and taught dance there for a week.
Just out of curiosity, is it Warsaw?
No, it was the smaller city nearby Warsaw.
Okay, so I actually did a book report in Warsaw when I was younger.
Well,
yeah.
It's a very interesting city.
And then Emma and I taught in Iceland. We also taught dance there because my parents live there, and there's a studio space there where they need international teachers and new eye for the kids, so we were there for them.
Nice.
I've also taught in Thailand. Yeah, it was really fun.
Wow.
Yeah. I taught to an organization that brings together hill tribe children to educate them, and once a year they have like an arts experience, and so we taught dance. That's really fun.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So that kind of segues to what we were talking about off camera. Totally think you guys should have an excursion annually, if not quarterly, to go to an exotic place like Thailand or Bali and have Pilates. And you guys know a lot of photographers, get someone with a drone, and you're literally creating your own viral content on IG, which is like the coolest things right now. A lot of the cool viral videos are drones.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys can actually practice here in the city since they're here.
Mm-hmm.
Well, only over water.
Yeah, exactly. I was about to say, what are the laws for drones in the city?
Because in Jersey, you can use drones, right? Because in Manhattan, you can't have any drones over the city.
Not even on a university campus like Columbia? Because I feel like that has a lot more land than most
maybe
university campuses.
To check into,
as far as I know, it was like only over water in the city.
Interesting. That's kind of a dangerous game to play in case it runs out of batteries. Here, right? Hope you guys know how to swim, right?
I just learned last summer, so.
Okay.
She taught me how to swim.
Oh, how to swim. Yeah.
Wait, really?
Yeah. Wow. Very afraid of water. Not anymore.
That's great.
But I was. Yeah.
Alright.
Yeah. Learning every day.
Because I'd be like, it'd be pretty cool to do dancing underwater.
Oh,
you know what
yeah.
I mean?
Yeah.
Because I myself have a GoPro, so I love underwater photography, mm-hmm. so that'd be pretty cool to do.
We should talk.
Oh, yeah, we should talk.
Absolutely. Again,
we're talking
furthermore.
Right now since the start.
Right. So, out of curiosity, as we talked about Valentine's Day in 2 days, how did you two meet? Was it through dance and Pilates or?
We met through school.
Ah.
So, we went to the same dance program at University of Wisconsin Stevens Point.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, we went to school together for about 3.5 years.
Yeah.
And she graduated, and then I graduated half year after that. You sticked around campus, right? Because you were doing other projects.
I was teaching with my mom in Minnesota.
Yeah. And then
you decided that you wanted to move to
New York. And I decided that we want to move to New York.
Great decision, right?
Yeah.
Well, because we talked about other cities like Seattle and LA. And then we did the whole pros and cons list.
And we did do that, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
Oh yeah, I forgot we made that pros and cons list.
Yeah, you made us make the list. Because otherwise we were not being convinced. And then New York had the most pros.
Nice.
Pros,
yeah.
I can see that. It's New York, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really good for dance. His family lives in Iceland. My family lives in Minnesota. It's in between the two.
It really is. Nice selection, yeah.
So whenever they want to visit, they visit, and you know, they stay at our house, and it's not like they have to fly all the way to LA, and it's more convenient.
Definitely.
Also, we have lots of good teachers here that we take class from. Like, we just came back from a class at Union Square with Janet Panetta, and she's a ballet mistress for this company in Germany called Pina Bausch.
Wow.
Yeah, and it's a major company in Europe, and she works in Europe, she works in New York. And she's been training us for about, so ever since we moved here. And I can see my technique getting better.
Yeah.
By day.
For sure.
Yeah. But yeah, especially like when you're consistent.
Little things like that brought us here for sure. Yeah.
And Pilates.
Yeah, we weren't really, and Pilates. We didn't finish our training here. But yeah, we weren't dating really before we moved here.
So you just guys, you decided to move here before, I mean, before you were dating? Just like together?
We were like really close friends.
It's complicated.
But it's like complicated.
When were dating when we moved here, no?
We had like, it was pretty fresh.
So
it was like we had
friends
been,
with benefits.
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, for sure.
No labels, no pressure.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. But then we really started dating basically when I graduated and I went to Iceland.
Did you guys see the Northern Lights there?
Not that time.
You did.
Kind of. Okay. I saw it one time when I didn't have my glasses on. I just saw some like vague.
They were lying in the bed, just like, is that it? And I looked at her, I was like, yeah, that's it. By the time you put your glasses on, it was gone. It just comes and goes.
Just like that.
Oftentimes it stays for like a whole night, or it just comes for 5 minutes and goes away, and it comes back in a month. So when people want to go travel twice in the winter, you know, it's like 50% that they'll see it.
That's what I hear.
Yeah.
I mean, that's kind of one of my goals on my bucket list. As you guys saw on my Instagram, I was able to go to Egypt, and that was on the top of my list because I'm obsessed with ancient culture, especially ancient Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
But the next is definitely to see the Northern Lights, Aurora Borealis.
Amazing.
I have to see that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, you can stay at my house.
There we go. Just like couch surfing, right?
Just like that.
So one of the concepts that I wanted to bring back that you guys brought up, which I think is pivotal when you're doing your passion, as both of you are both still committed to learning your craft. Like it's like a lifetime learning. That's a huge concept, especially for younger kids who don't really understand that concept of like being diligent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But when you're passionate about something, it never feels like work.
No.
So when you're going, it's... So granted, you guys got to go to a dance school, so that I feel like that was a different experience.
That was a lot of work.
But it was still considered more work because I feel like you had a broader range of dances that you had to learn.
Mm-hmm.
And then after you graduate, you get to focus on what you actually really want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're actually in control of what you do every day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like I said, it's not only a physical way, but also intellectual way. Like after college, we continued to study anatomy with also teachers here in New York.
Really? That's
Irene Dowd is one of them. She's a Juilliard anatomist, and we study with her for a few years now. But like on the physical level too, Emma takes class pretty much every day. I try to take class every other day. Modern, jazz, ballet. What do we
you
like?
You still take jazz?
Yeah.
When was the last time you took a jazz class?
Half a year ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
So what are the type of things you guys learn in the anatomy classes?
Like everything, skin, tissue, bones, all of it.
Really?
Yeah, and the focus usually is kinesthetic anatomy because that's just what applies the most to dance. So just like how the body moves, how the body functions, and what are the ways you can break that down to make it the most efficient possible.
That sounds really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is really
there's
cool.
There's a lot of freedom, you know, in movement, but then there's all this physics and science that all makes sense.
Wow.
with spirals and spinning. When you spin a little fidget spinner, it's like us spinning in a circle. So like, how are we holding our form is important throughout the whole trajectory of that.
Okay, is that similar to how ice figure skaters do their little... Oh, okay.
What
are those? Pirouettes?
They pirouettes. Do, definitely, yeah. Probably. They definitely...
Definitely, maybe.
ballet every day.
Wow.
I would assume they do ballet, and then they go on the skates. But,
okay.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah, but learning anatomy, not just for dance, but like... being able to improve performance in running or biking or tennis, so many different things.
Absolutely, and I would definitely put it in the same category as athletics, because I'm sure you guys learn about recovery and in that aspect
as prevention.
Absolutely, and some of the biggest athletes in the world, from Cristiano Ronaldo to LeBron James, even do Pilates on a regular basis as a part of their recovery. Absolutely.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, a lot of people tease him for it, but like, look at LeBron. I'm like, why are you teasing him for it? Like,
figuring something out.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I myself, who was a former basketball player, really looking into Pilates and yoga because I have very long limbs.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like that's really great for my body specifically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, a lot of, so there's mat work in Pilates, and then there's also the apparatus, which is like a whole bunch of spring based
is that when you
resistance.
Go like that and kind of with your legs? Is that
you could
that
do,
mechanism?
You could do anything,
yeah.
Really. Any movement you can do with the springs, really.
Gives you the feedback. Right?
It gives you proprioceptive feedback, it gives you resistance, you can strengthen. It's really cool. And it's so much harder if you have long limbs.
Oh,
it's
great.
So much harder. But it's good because then you get stronger faster.
It's true.
So
yeah.
we have a company called Z Moves. My name is Mariusz, it's ends with a Z, and then Emma starts with an A, so Z-E moves. You can say it in French if you want to say it. Z moves.
The Z moves!
Yes,
right?
Just like that.
The
yeah.
Z moves.
And so if, like for you, for example, you're in Jersey, you don't get to come to the city every day, and you want to see Pilates, you can go to on our YouTube channel and then see the videos there and practice on your own, and then you can shoot us a little DM on Instagram and then with a little video, like, am I doing this right? We'll give you feedback. We're very open to that.
That's pretty cool. And we're just gonna make sure we put the Instagram handles on the bottom, in the bottom third, so we can plug that, absolutely.
So
guys, definitely check out their Instagram, because I checked it out before just to do the research. Very, very impressed, especially all of those dance photography photos. I mean, tell the truth, how many takes did it take to get that perfect picture? Because those are perfect pictures.
Yeah. Well, we have a capture, it's called Capture Dances, and the concept is that it's a meetup, and dancers don't usually know the photographers, and so it's kind of just like a, like, you start dancing, and someone takes the photo, so like, if they get the shot, maybe, or maybe not, but there's not too much like, oh, let's try this again at this angle. It's more like free movement, and the photographers are like running around trying to get it. But that's kind of why we started it, because we felt that not a lot of dancers had a lot of experience in front of the camera. That's changed a little bit since we started, but still. And not a lot of photographers had a lot of experience getting movement, because it's hard.
Absolutely.
So it was a cool opportunity for both sides.
Yeah, we got really good feedback from photographers, which I was personally surprised with, because that one woman messaged us and she was like, that was super cool to just be able to take a photo and look at it, and then just be like, oh, I only have one arm in this photo. Maybe I should go a little bit back. Having that dancer in her frame, because it's always constant movement. It was a challenge for her, but she came back. So we tried doing those at least once a month. The winter is a little harder because it's outside, often sunrise or sunset, if we're not feeling like we want to wake up that early. And it's cold, so our bodies are not that ready to do that perfect leap, to do that perfect vama, to get that fullest stretch. So we're working on finding some spaces right now, indoor, with a good morning light to
for
shoot.
For free.
Yeah.
It's for free.
For free.
In New York City, brother. Right? Well, if you guys would actually play connector from the photographers to, let's say, real estate agents, there's probably some real estate agents who know the perfect property who has that. Mm-hmm. Get a photographer who can shoot the,
absolutely,
you know, shoot the photos for them for the listing. Might be able to work something out. Never know.
You think so?
No,
does
so.
That make sense?
Okay.
Yeah,
right.
Totally.
I've thought about that before, but I was like, that's crazy.
Free advertising for everybody.
Exactly.
That's true.
And I'm not gonna lie, I watch a lot of HGTV because my parents kind of put me on it, and I'm kind of obsessed with modern architecture. So this room, I absolutely love. It's pretty cool. It's very simple, but also very productive and efficient. So what they do on the show called Selling New York, so it's a lot of high-end real estate in New York City. So what the brokers do, the real estate brokers, they host events and parties. So imagine if you guys were performing at one of the listings, but then you also get to have that photography as well and the video as well. So it's kind of like everyone kind of works together.
I've done that before.
Love that
We've danced in galleries. Collaborated with some artists. One artist we collaborated, her name is Carol Furman, and she's a sculptress. Ooh. And she does hyper-realistic sculptures for people. She just did one of Emma, and it's in Miami right now.
Oh, really?
But, so we got to dance around the sculptures and mimic the sculptures, what they're doing, and interact with the audience, and we presented that both in LA and here. So we're used to dancing in a concrete floor. Not the best for us, but...
Exactly. Especially in the cold, right?
Yeah,
cold,
especially
and
in cold.
Oh my gosh, I can imagine.
Warm space.
That kind of reminds me of the MoMA. So I'm a member of the MoMA in the Guggenheim. Love those places. Love modern art. So imagine if you guys had that exhibit here. I think that should be a very realistic goal in 2 to 3 years, if not less. Very ambitious, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So you're learning a lot about cameras from being around photographers and angles and whatnot.
And frame.
Hmm. I wonder what would happen if you became a photographer as well, especially what you know about the body and whatnot, anatomy. I feel like that'd be a great, great correlation for you to know specifically what to focus on, specifically for dancers.
Yeah, I like doing video.
Okay.
More than like stills. I've done a few like videos. I've done a camera dance in college.
So you rather do videos as opposed to stills?
Yeah, I've done a few camera dances in college. We had a class called Camera Dance, Dance on Camera, where we were both the dancer, director, photographer, producer, and we were cutting, working with Final Cut Pro, putting people in frame, and doing all the makeup and costumes, everything. So that taught me a lot. And then when we came here, I've also done a few little videos with my iPhone mostly. But I like cutting it. I like putting it together. It kind of reminds me of composition. It's definitely like composition, like in choreography. When I have a few dancers or we choreograph together and we have a few dancers on stage and we're like, no, you go there, you go here, go more front, go back, you know. And that's kind of like that cutting of the video reminds me of that.
It definitely reminds me of playing the piano, because I played the piano growing up, and I have a couple of videos on YouTube as well that have a couple thousand views. I was actually surprised when I saw. I was like, wait, what? People actually watch that? But
YouTube is so cool, right?
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
This is also going to go on YouTube as well, just FYI.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, we started YouTube about a month ago, and we like it because it's not like a place where on Instagram it comes and goes and disappears. Even if it's like IGTV, it's somewhere in your profile there, hidden. But on YouTube, people look up what they're interested in. So they would look up, like for us, they would maybe look up Pilates or how to rehabilitate my knee or how do I get a little taller, my posture gets a little bit better. And then hopefully they'll land on our page where we describe all these moves.
That's pretty cool. The Zemos, right? So what you literally just described is how you go viral on YouTube. From what people, just reverse engineer what people search, because essentially you're using SEO. So search engine optimization, and YouTube, you know, they're owned by Google, so they use the same algorithm on how you find things. So if you continue to essentially title your videos based on those specific searches, I don't see how you wouldn't go viral within the year.
So it's really cool that we started capture dances, because like, you know, I like video. Emma really likes photography. You like doing the 35 millimeter captions?
I do a lot of film photography, just for fun.
Nice.
Yeah. But it's costly. I'm like, ready to go more digital again.
Right.
Yeah.
So how did you get into photography?
I think my dad gave me his camera, and one or both of my parents were just taught me how to use it, and I just kept taking photos and getting them developed. A couple years ago, I finally learned how to like go in the dark room and process that.
Wow.
That's fun, but you need like a lot of time and patience.
I can imagine, yeah.
So I was like, maybe not for me right now. But it was a cool process to go through. Really interesting. Yeah. Both my parents are artists, so I've always been exposed.
It's just in the ether, if you will, yeah. Of the family, right? I kind of have a theory that I've been working on. So a little bit about me. The first 9 months of 2018, I was consciously celibate, so that gave me a lot of time to process my mind, basically, mm-hmm. without any distractions. So I was able to make what I consider a lot of revelations. So one of the connections that I saw was how not only is our DNA passed on to, you know, our offspring, but also our mindsets and mm-hmm. essentially our energy.
Totally.
And then if you talk to biologists who actually can look at the blood, you can actually see that certain traits can be transferred via the blood.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah. And like if you have ancestral trauma that can be like passed down through your DNA.
Exactly.
It's mind-blowing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, essentially DNA is the coolest hard drive ever mm-hmm. with like limitless space almost. Yeah.
See the celibate?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I mean, like we do sometimes meditation, which also gets us out of our body, more into the mind.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And especially with my sun sign, so I'm an Aquarius, so I'm very, crown chakra.
It's your season, right?
Absolutely, it is my season. It was my birthday on Saturday, and my mom's
birthday. Birthday.
Thank you, and my mom's birthday was on Sunday, so we're both Aquarians.
That's my moon.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So my rising is also Aquarius, too. So, like, I have 360 degrees of Aquarius.
Oh, wow.
Just, like, in water. That's where you like the GoPro.
Exactly. Thank you. You get it. By the way, side note, if it sounds like we have this crazy connection, we do. It's because we're all only children, which is awesome.
We are. We just met, too.
Right? So, are you guys into spirituality at all?
Yeah, I mean, we've definitely delved a little bit deeper into spirituality like this last year, and it kind of corresponds. We recently just kind of did a lot of purging in our life of like jobs and what else. It was like a whole bunch of just like negative stuff that we recently just kind of like exited out of our lives, and that just allowed us so much more time to explore our spirituality. So. Yeah, getting into more meditation has been really awesome and enlightening.
Yeah, we went from a full-time job of 40, 30, maybe 35 hours a week.
Of teaching Pilates.
Classes, Pilates, constantly like 4, 5, 6 hours a day.
Wow.
To teaching 3 hours a week. So now we have time for meditation.
Exactly. And a lot of other things too.
And then, yeah
our and brand. A lot of other things.
The capture dances. We want to travel. We're going to Portland, just because to see Portland. Emma really wants to go to Portland. So one day she's like, "We're going to Portland," and I was like, "Okay, let's go. Let's see what's there. Maybe we'll move there."
So then I was looking at Emma's Instagram. So I saw one of the stories. I think it's called Preserve or Sustain. Sustain. So could you talk to me more about that? Because I actually went vegan. 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So 2 years ago, gave up meat. Last year, gave up, you know. So, right? Essentially everything, right?
All the joys in life.
Right? So, very focused on, you know, how different things affect not only our mind and our body and our spirit, and how I can consciously put all of the things together. Because
mm-hmm.
I think if you look at every single religion on earth, they all talk about being conscious of your mind, body, and spirit, and have them all working together. And especially when we're working together with Mother Earth and sustaining
mm-hmm.
and, you know, finding things in your own backyard, I think that's a very healthy mindset.
Yeah. Yeah, so we're we're trying, you know, it's really impossible because we live in a linear economy and we not a circular, so we're trying as best we can to be as plastic free as possible. For one, we're vegetarian, we're not vegan. I just like eggs and cheese a lot. And honey.
Vegetarian for a long time.
But I've been a vegetarian since I was 10, so this is like...
I'm not a vegetarian.
Oh yeah, he's not a vegetarian. Yeah. But he mostly.
Yeah, basically.
Mostly.
<Being
convinced. laughs> So, that's been my like activism since I was like 10. But because we have more time, we've been more zero waste and trying to like make things our own, and we have a garden on our balcony where, yeah, we like last summer we almost for like a good 3 months like mostly ate from our balcony.
Wow.
Which was pretty cool.
Okay.
Yeah. And yeah, so just try not to.
We cook a lot.
We cook a lot.
That's awesome. And I found this recipe called compost broth. And don't let that scare you. So it's basically when we make food, all the scraps that are still at a sort of, they're not rotten, like the onions, the ends of a garlic, a little bit of a carrot, and we put it all in a little container and put it in the freezer.
So it doesn't rot.
Oh. It's not rot. It's just called compost broth. And so then we take it out after like a week or sometimes even 3 days, and we put it in our Instapot, or we put it in our pot and boil it and get the water, the broth from it. And then based on that broth, we can make any sort of soup. We can make like a cucumber, tomato, potato, carrot, any kind of soup from that.
It sounds like you guys have a cookbook coming out. The sustainable cookbook, right?
We did do a few little videos on like how to make that compost broth, but we're still in the process of
We got a really funny response because everyone was like, ew, gross.
But,
but it's actually really...
It.
Some people tried it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Your cousin tried it.
Oh, yeah, Elizabeth.
But my question is, if it's not decomposed, what makes it gross? Because we like all those foods anyway. You know?
Right?
No, it's just the name. I think it was the name.
I think it's a creative
name. We wanted to like catch someone's attention. We also looked
like,
it up.
Exactly. It's very adventurous. If you're not adventurous.
What if I just said scraps, bro? It looks like a little less. Compost. Makes you think.
You definitely visualize it. Oh, wow.
These people.
Yeah.
We're
pretty big on like cutting our food waste down as well. So it's kind of surprising when you take all those scraps, like how much volume of food you actually have, and you're just throwing it away. And then what you can do, if you boil it down, first of all, you get all those nutrients into your body, but then also you cut down on the food waste because you've just like taken this much and just smushed it down to this much.
And we also compost that bit, and then we put it in our plants.
Yeah.
Wow.
In the summer.
Okay. So that's nutrients for the plants as well. That's really good. Yeah.
And we tried to be, like you said, plastic free. Yesterday we went to a store with zero waste. There's this Brooklyn store in Brooklyn.
I did see that stuff. I saw that store.
First one in Brooklyn, which is surprising because Brooklyn is so big. But it's zero waste. So when you walk in, there's no plastic bags. Nothing is wrapped in plastic. Everything is in jars. You can buy your own jar and put your flour or rice or whatever in the jar, and you bring it home and you bring the jar back, and it that way is less waste in the world.
It was really cool, but huge hassle. And had we not had the privilege to have all that time to go across Brooklyn and then carry all the jars home, it would just like wouldn't be possible.
And now we have to go back because someone forgot their bag.
Oh, and I forgot my book.
Wait, at the store.
Okay.
Well, do they still have it?
Yeah, they have.
All right, that's cool.
Yeah, we gotta go after it.
But yeah, that's our next step is aquaponics.
What is that?
It's vertical farming. But aquaponics is where you take a fish tank, which we have one, and you like make a vertical farm coming out of it, and it's like self-sustaining mostly. I think you still have to water the plants, but the plants feed off of the fish poop. It's cool.
That's pretty cool.
It's farming of the future.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So that kind of reminds me of Irish sea moss gel that I actually take on a daily basis.
Ah.
You guys as dancers probably want to look into that.
Yeah.
And how to make it so it really keeps the joints limber, and it limits the amount of soreness you have.
Not really.
So it's really great for joint health and bone health.
What's it called?
And as a vegan, that's probably the only way I can naturally get vitamin B12. Because usually it's only, you can only get it, you know, in capsules, or you would actually have to have meat.
Right. Yeah. I'm always scared because sometimes I find myself B12 deficient.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I'm always scared that if I start taking the capsules, I'll start to like take too much.
Right. And then your liver. Yeah.
Yeah. What's it called?
Irish sea moss gel.
Irish sea moss gel.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a capsule?
Oh no, actually it comes as seaweed. And then you bring it back to life. So you put, I actually use alkaline water.
Cool.
So you put it back in water and then it retakes its shape, so it grows a lot. And then you mince it and put it into a blender and just add a little bit of water,
mm-hmm.
blend it up, and then add a little bit more. So it's more like a gel. It kind of looks like applesauce.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
Where do you get that?
I get it from Amazon. And just make sure you get the wildcrafted kind, because there's a lot of farms that do it, but you definitely want the wildcrafted for it to have its actual nutrients that you want. So instead of like all the fish farms that are growing salmon, you actually want like the actual fish. And then you actually understand the ecosystem, because you're essentially eating what fish are eating, which is why it's healthy for us to eat fish. But if you're eating their food source, but it's in a sustainable way, then it helps everyone. And the fish are alive, so there you go.
Cool.
Yeah.
Does
that, so I have so many questions about this. So it's wild.
Wildcrafted.
Crafted. What does that mean?
It means that it's not farmed. So you're actually getting it from the ocean.
Okay. But they have like a certain way that they take it.
Exactly. So it's not detrimental to the environment, which is cool.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Maybe we can grow it in our fish tank.
That's why I brought it up. Like if you guys could figure that out.
What's your message? Yeah.
Yeah.
We have some moss in there.
We have something. I don't think that would be great. Okay. We'll figure something.
Wait, are you guys going to have fish in there as well?
We have fish there.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a new project. We have a lot of hobbies.
I see. I hope you guys document all of this. Because I would literally watch on a daily basis.
I'm just going to be like, ZTV.
Oh, yes. Yes. You heard it first. ZTV.
I like that. You're like Oprah.
Yeah.
No. The Z.
It's Emma, you have so much knowledge about the pineal gland because you're reading a book about it. Could you tell us about it?
You can maybe help me out a little bit because I'm really just getting into like the precipice of what this means. But your pineal gland is basically, has a lot of functions and can make melatonin, am I saying that right? And serotonin. And it also can pick up different frequencies that are faster than light. So basically it's like antenna in your head. And once it starts picking up those higher frequencies, it starts releasing melatonin and serotonin and starts converting that into new chemicals that can like actually change your body and change your DNA. It's kind of crazy.
Absolutely, it's really, really cool. And that was a great description. So I would also add in there, it also produces DMT.
Yes.
So
if you really go there.
If you really want to go there. So this is DMT is the chemical that produces our out-of-body experiences. So that's why it's really connected to spirituality and the pineal gland, so the third eye and the crown chakra and all those other things. So one of the reasons why it's important for us to have full functionality of our pineal gland is that that's how you connect all the chakras.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
About chakras?
Mm-hmm.
I'm still working on opening them up.
Yeah, opening up the chakras.
Yes.
Yeah, and that's how people do ayahuasca,
mm-hmm.
Which I haven't done maybe like 3 years now. I don't know.
I'm kind of nervous to take it. Just,
I'm super nervous.
Just the fact that everything's coming out from both sides of
everything
your body.
Is coming out.
Do you know
what
I mean?
Yeah.
I would kind of rather just do DMT and just, you know, smoke it that way as opposed to drinking it in ayahuasca that just makes you purge all substances from your body.
From everywhere. Yeah. You swear. You...
Why would you want to do that?
Well, like, it's guiding you through. And there's like...
The shaman.
Yeah, the shaman and... I've heard there's people singing, which is really cool.
Right.
I don't know. That sounds a pretty cool experience, maybe.
People do have cool revelations, I feel like, about their body and their mind, how they're living their life for the economy that we have right now, you know. It's good to get away and come back and see it fresh.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Definitely always good to have a new perspective on things, because sometimes we get tunnel vision in a bad way. Like kind of how we talked about before, when we're actually focused, like when you guys are dancing and in the zone, that type of, I would say, in the moment focus is pivotal, especially for what we're doing and when we're working or sometimes playing, right? Kind of like when you're a kid and you're just having fun, you don't care what happens and you just totally get lost of time. But when we have tunnel vision based, I would say, on our concepts in society, then that's, I would say, very dangerous to have a universal consciousness that's focused in on lower frequency.
Mm-hmm. And they definitely see the tunnel vision in New York, because we're very like, let's go. I don't want to talk to anybody. I don't even see you. And then your peripheral vision closes on you, and then like if you go out to a field, you don't see all, you're like very overwhelmed because you haven't been practicing that gate. And Pilates really helps with that, opening up the peripheral vision, the gate, working with the body as a whole.
It kind of works both two ways. Like meditation is so important for Pilates also, because you need to be able to like totally reset your whole nervous system so that you can create new patterns in your body and make it more efficient. Because if you don't have that like blank slate to start from, it's so much harder.
Yeah, it helps with precision too. Because we ask our clients to focus, to breathe, be very precise. If we tell them to pick their leg, I don't necessarily need them to move their whole body and then, you know, move, wiggle around and then pick up the leg. I just want them to pick up the leg. And that simple task, for a lot of times for people, is very difficult because they just want to do the most. Mm. And, you know, we're in New York, so we just want to do all these things in a minute and then be done and then go home. And Pilates is more of a process,
right,
of our training that we had. That's how we learned that.
Yeah. So you really have to slow down and kind of take it in the moment, right? Mm-hmm. And focus on that one movement. Because mm-hmm. I feel like, I know me as a basketball player, sometimes we would have to focus, as a former basketball player, we would have to focus on doing a lot of intense movements, which I feel like is the modern notion in terms of bodybuilding. It's a gym mentality. Mm-hmm. But I would say things like yoga and Pilates, it takes more of the intensity out of it. It is intense, but just not in the way that most people are used to it. And like how you were saying, you're retraining their minds to be intense in a different way.
Yeah, because you have to really break down and isolate different movements so that when you have to do a whole bunch of things together all at once with a lot of force, those connections happen really fast and you don't have to do all the excess things.
They're subconscious, like, because you trained your body to think, it's already there in your muscle memory. Where we started doing personal training with our friend, and we started to lift weights, which we've been opposed for a while because I just felt like it was hard for my body, but actually it really helps me to connect with my muscles. And from having the training as a dancer and Pilates, knowing that everything comes from the core, comes from the center, comes from midline, and it radiates from there, definitely helped me to be more confident with weightlifting. And I would recommend getting a trainer, because one time I lifted and I did the bar, and on one side there was 5 pounds, the other side was 10.
Oh!
And I was lifting, doing a whole video, I even posted on Instagram, and then I looked at it and I said, why are they uneven? And then my post trainer was like, you put the wrong weights. So that happened. So.
Tunnel vision, I guess.
I was really focused on the camera.
That's pretty cool. Like I really think there's a key behind the blend of going from yoga to Pilates to also weightlifting in a moderate way, and it's finding a balance between all of those things. Mm-hmm. It's pretty cool. And meditation as well. I really want to get into meditation. One of my best friends who's kind of been my guide in spirituality and introducing me to the chakras, he's been teaching me how to meditate, because I'm really, really bad at that. As an only child, I'm sure you guys know this, our isolation kind of is our strength, I believe. Because I feel like we kind of conquered what, and I hate to say this, but what I feel the majority of people in the world kind of loathe, which is isolation and being loneliness. But people got to realize loneliness is a strength. But I also feel like that also is a pathway to meditation, because you kind of have to be empty in here. Like it's total emptiness, and you have to kind of go into the dark.
Yeah.
Just
surrender.
Yeah, right? That's a beautiful word though. Like that's exactly what you have to do. And I guess for me, I'm a person who's always, like you guys have interacted with me for a couple minutes now. Like you see, I'm always have these ideas, and it's kind of hard for me to turn that off. So it's really gonna take a lot of effort for me to do that. But I really wanna try. This year is going to be the year.
Yeah, a lot of practice.
Yeah, you mentioned meditation, weightlifting, Pilates, yoga. Where we work for WeWork, called Rise by We, they offer all, the wellness center offer all these things. So you can build your own program, you can come to our classes, you can come to our friends' classes to take yoga, and then they also have a spa, you can go to the spa and relax, and then go take a little boxing or cardio, and then you go on with your life.
It's a really cool concept. So they have WeWork, they have Rise by We, but they also have We Live, which is also an Airbnb as well.
They also have We Grow.
We Grow?
Yeah.
What's that?
I think they're focusing on kids.
Oh.
And their education with growing plants and planting on their own. You know, when you're a child, you just want to do things with your hands, and
they
encourage that.
It's really cool. It's a really cool concept. Mm-hmm. So I kind of want to take advantage of that in the future.
They have a free week.
Really?
They do have a free week. All you have to do is go on the website.
Nice. I was definitely investigating it as well. And did you ever see their Instagram?
Mm-hmm. What about it?
I was just saying, I feel like you guys should probably have a partnership with them.
Okay.
You know, as an influencer, someone with 20,000 followers here, right?
Yeah. We're always working on developing new programs and working together and trying to give our skills to them and then their resources to us. They're very open to bringing us in and teaching people, or bringing someone else and teaching us. It's a very well-rounded community.
That's really cool.
Did you ever use visualization in basketball?
All the time.
Yeah.
So we were taught to visualize the ball going through the hoop. Some coaches like to say aim for the back of the rim, because you know, three-dimensional circle, so aim for the back. But if you aim for the back, you might be hitting the backboard, or if you hit like the sweet spot in the back of the rim, it'll bounce up and go all the way there. So it's actually great to do specific visualizations, as you guys were saying, to go actually in. Like see the sphere go through.
See the success, like
absolutely
embodying that, yeah.
And if you think about some of the best players like LeBron James or Kobe Bryant, they visualize that all the time.
They have to.
Especially if they're missing. If they miss 10 shots in a row, they can't stop shooting. Everyone's expecting them to be great, so you can't stop shooting. You can't hide guys. There's millions of people watching you. So you gotta keep shooting, right?
Yeah, that's often what we focus on in our class at the beginning. We try to do a little visualization of scanning your body, relaxing all the unnecessary tensions so that you can hone in on your practice and then be present. For private classes, for Z moves, or for group classes, we start like that. Emma just taught for Lil Lemon last week, and you started a class
too. Yeah, at the Lululemon Lab.
Yeah, we taught meditation Pilates.
How was that?
Meditative Pilates.
It was really nice. We taught, it was like 15 minutes of meditation at the beginning and the end. So there was like less Pilates, but there's so much research out there on like how powerful your mind can be if you just like visualize yourself doing the action. And then studies show that your body thinks that you did it. If you've made that visualization real in your head, your body thinks that you did it. So it's like, sometimes, like, if you get really good at meditation, you could really just meditate and you would have, like, a six-pack.
I love that concept, because it kind of reminds me of deja vu a little bit.
Yeah. The brain connects with the nervous system, and the nervous system sends the signal to the muscles, get ready, they're about to do something, and then it's actually not any movement, but you have that thought, and then you have the connection, you have that impulse, and that's how that works, right?
Yeah, because you've trained your nervous system already.
Mm-hmm. Through like neural pathways, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's essentially physical affirmations, because the whole concept of affirmations is saying it, and then you already believe that you've done it already. And then what you guys are talking about, something even deeper, which is even cooler, I had no idea about, that I want to try now.
A little visualization goes a long way.
Yeah.
It's kind of crazy.
Mm. And then dance too. We were taught to visualize our success and like turns, pirouettes, jumps, partnering. First we visualize what we do, and then we do it, and then we do it, visualize again, just in case we didn't visualize the success.
It makes a lot of sense. So I have to ask you guys, because I know footwork is paramount in dancing, mm-hmm. as it is in basketball. I would say a third of our training had to do with footwork. Because if you don't have the right footwork, you can sprain an ankle. That's right. How you have injuries. So like how you guys said, visualization, that you got to visualize yourself actually planning correctly. And I'm thinking about gymnasts as well, right? Yeah. Because if you don't, the result could be catastrophic.
Yeah. Ankle mobility is so important. Foot mobility is so important.
Right?
We should all just be walking barefoot, but, you know.
I kind of want
it's
to.
It's New York, so it's kind of gross.
Yeah. Well, we should just probably all move to the beach. It'd be a lot easier.
Yeah.
Hawaii, here we go.
Right? Next stop, Bali, right?
Wait, so you said LA, so LA, Hawaii, Bali, right there.
Oh,
right,
there you go.
Yeah.
A whole month.
Just like island hop.
Yeah.
We will make that happen.
Absolutely. Awesome.
You just gotta visualize it.
Yes. And as a way to get more athletes, now that I'm thinking about it, as a former athlete, if you talk about the successes of athletes who religiously do Pilates, mm-hmm. I would feel like you have a lot more people more open to it.
Yeah, yeah, totally. I think there's currently, well, Pilates has a whole history, especially with dancers, and you know, then there's like the whole Jane Fonda era where she like took Pilates to like a whole new, new level. But now we're at a really cool place, I think, where more people, it's expanding, and more people are discovering Pilates and how it can be good for you. So I hope that it keeps expanding, because Pilates is just so, so cool. What was the question?
And expanding and evolving too.
It's expanding and evolving, yeah.
Yeah. Joseph Pilates was very into innovating. He was always innovating new equipment, adding springs to certain things just to optimize your workout.
He was always making like different equipment, all sorts of different apparatus, like chairs. He wanted everybody to do Pilates. His some of his original equipment is like literally a bed with like springs attached to the headboard.
Wow.
Because he wanted everyone to like wake up and start doing Pilates. but it's a very cool concept, because you can explore so many new ranges and things that you wouldn't be able to do without the support of springs or the support of the equipment that it provides. This is really awesome.
Yeah, talking about the athletes, or even talking about our own experiences with our clients, where we would help somebody and guide them through the process of rehabilitation or getting better in their bodies. Like, I've had a few clients with nervous system injuries, like paralyzed side.
Wow.
And we worked on little exercises that would waken up their nervous system, and they could go back to work.
Wow.
They came in with like, I can't work right now, I need to focus on my body, and we would work for 3 months or half a year, and then all of a sudden they come back and they're like, I'm at work. I'm like, what are you doing at work? I thought you didn't work. Mm-hmm. It's like, I feel strong, now I can hold this couple, and then, you know, do the surgery again.
That's amazing. So you're also essentially a physical therapist as well.
Oh yeah, people all the time are like, they just got out of rehab from, you know, ankle injury or something, and they're like, oh, this is like physical therapy. I'm like, yes, it basically is. But it, in so many more ways, because it just has so many, so many benefits of, people get to tone, people like get to feel good in their body, be confident with themselves, get strong, and also just like focus on those little things that are gonna make you really efficient in the body.
But unlike physical therapists, we can focus on the whole body and where the movement comes from. Like if you are a physical therapist, you need to follow the note from the doctor. The doctor says his neck is injured, work on his neck. And then the physical therapist does all sorts of things for your neck. But if you come to my private session and you say, my neck is injured, I have a herniated disc in my cervical spine, I will probably start with you with breath, core work, activation from the center, and then, like I said earlier, like radiating from that, the limbs, your head is your limbs. So if it all comes from here and goes out,
yeah, sometimes
it's the best way of healing.
You can have a neck injury and really the problem is your foot. You have a dysfunctional foot and that's
absolutely
why your neck hurts. So being able to look at the whole body is really a gift.
It's really cool for sure. So I actually switched my primary doctor because I had to. My former doctor retired. And my new doctor is actually a DO, which means that they focus on, as you guys were saying, the entire body, as opposed to, because they're still board certified from the medical board, but they focus on the body as a whole. So instead of, I would say conventional medicine says if you have a headache, treat the headache, but it could be something, like you said, in the intestines.
Yeah, or that, in your armpit.
Absolutely, that could be the problem, and you never even know. So in the realm of acupuncture and all those other cool Eastern philosophical healing techniques, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's so cool. Yeah, right, I don't know if it's like society right now or like what's happening, but I just see like our world of health in the US slowly expanding.
It is.
It's very exciting.
Very exciting.
I would say, if it's not already, it should be a tangible goal for Pilates to be considered physical therapy that could be paid by insurance.
Absolutely.
Yes.
In at least 3 to 5 years, I'm thinking. Yeah. Especially with our age group, who's very open to that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see how they couldn't.
Yeah, or even
some insurance does.
Oh, awesome. Okay.
But not many.
I remember
not enough, right?
Yeah, not enough.
Pilates to younger generation. At school, you know, we learn squats and you learn all sorts of games, but to those teachers really pay attention to your alignment and make sure you don't get injured. You come home and you're like, oh, my knee hurts. And then 10 years later, you're like, oh, you know, the one time I was at the gym, my knee was hurting and it's still hurting now. So like if they were educated in a way that's more of a anatomically based, or bring us in and we can, you know, help them out with all sorts of tasks, games for kids to still stay engaged, but be healthy and work from the core. I think that would also help.
Absolutely. I mean, that would help a lot of things. Like, think about all the, I feel like all of the diseases that would probably be wiped away simply from aligning that.
Yeah.
I mean, the body is a magical device. Like, it can heal itself.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll be teaching kids how to heal themselves, or their bodies how to heal itself even better from a younger age.
Starting young, right?
So it'd be like on autopilot, right?
Yeah. Well, your body changes a lot when you're a kid, though.
That's true.
Sometimes
keep that
training.
Muscle memory.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree.
So yeah, with IGTV, apparently the algorithm, because everyone knows the algorithm updated. So the way that the algorithm works now, if you have more video content, it's going to be more favorable to your account. And especially if you start using the functionality of IGTV, because they're being very competitive with YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a lot more IGTV content and then a lot more views that way, it'll also amplify your essentially your account.
Yeah.
And especially for you guys have a lot of great stories on Instagram. So if you just one time decided to do a promotion for like a week, I think it's like for 6 days it's $30 for a story.
Mm-hmm.
And then your story is that ad that when you scroll through everyone else's story, it could be your ad and be like, oh, come have fun with us.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys could be do a lot of cool dance moves and
yeah, people can find us that way.
Absolutely.
People can also Google Z moves and we're on the first page. We pop out as the first page and you go and book, and you can book anything you want. You go to our booking app and there's group classes, private lessons. You have an option of booking a retreat. If you want us, you know, to come to your house, there's in-home sessions as well.
Really?
We travel.
So you guys are like doctors on call.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Our privates, we have access to all the Pilates equipment, so you can try it out too. Get a full body assessment, and then we'll like do a little consulting on like what do we think. It's a good program.
Listen
for
to your
you
goals
as an individual with your goals, your body.
So it was very customized.
Very customized. Very, very. That's the cool thing about Pilates. It's like you can really tune into those like little tiny details of each person. It's endlessly.
Which is super exciting.
It's endlessly interesting.
Especially for us.
Yeah.
I like looking at my clients and just being like, oh my gosh, you look so much better than last week. What? How did that happen?
Right.
And then they say, well, I come 3 times a week, so something's better be working.
Yeah.
Almost 95% of the time, our clients walk out taller. 95 is low, right? 99.
Taller, yeah.
That's really the like signature of success in a session is like if they walk out taller than they came in.
They have a feedback of I feel stretched, and what they mean by that they feel space, not only in, like the vertebrae but also in their joint capsules and the space between the fascia, the bones, the muscles. They just feel a little bit more width, a little bit more blood flow, and they always say I feel stretched. Though the next day they text me like I'm so sore. In my legs, in my glutes, in my arms, in my core. But
Remember
the first reaction
every time
is...
you laugh.
Yeah, it hurts when I laugh. Yeah, when you do a lot of Pilates, your core gets super strong. And the next day, it hurts when you laugh. So maybe don't go to a comedy show.
Yes. You use that one a lot.
I just made it up.
Start using that more. That's perfect. Start using that more.
On the fire.
Yeah, right. So, and then you guys have the partnership with Lululemon as well, right?
Yes. Next week, we're doing a dance class. It's Thursday night at the Lululemon Lab.
Where is that anyway?
It's on Bond and Broadway.
Okay.
They do like, I think, I'm not sure like what the whole story is, but they like experiment with their clothes. So they have like way different clothes than the normal Lululemon. It's more like urban kind of style.
So you guys are gonna get like new access to different clothes, right?
Yeah, they give us an outfit.
We did teach a Pilates class there last week, meditative Pilates class session, which we do for events, and they did give us an outfit. I'm wearing this shirt.
Nice.
Yeah. Thanks, Lululemon Lab. Thanks, Maya.
Yeah.
So. It's possible that, you know, maybe by the end of the month, you guys could be Lululemon athletes. You know, I'm just putting it out
there.
Do
they do that?
Yes.
They do that, yeah.
They definitely do that.
Adidas does it, Nike does it, everybody does it.
Yeah. I'm really into sustainability, as we talked about. So right now, I'm trying really hard not to, like, acquire material things. It's a balance because I'm trying to like support other people, but also at the same time stay true to like, you know, we don't need to build material things. Yeah.
And we want to be more selective with who we working with in that aspect as well, because we could do we do also do photo shoots for our Z moves and capture dances. I direct them, Emma also directs them. We do movement directing for other people, other photographers and models. But so when we work with those people, with those brands, we try to pick brands that are sustainably friendly. And so we can spread that awareness as well. Because if, you know, I don't want to work with plastic clothes and then talk on my stories about how I'm plastic free.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So just out of curiosity, could you guys give, I guess, your top three favorite sustainability brands? Because I off the top of my head, I don't know any. Because I'm not really searching for that yet. Now that I know you guys, I'm gonna be conscious about it now. But just out of curiosity, what brands are great at that?
You know, it's interesting right now. My personal philosophy is that there just doesn't need to be any new stuff. Like, there's so many clothes out there. Like, we should all just go to like Buffalo Exchange and like thrift stores. And there's a lot of brands right now doing things, and it's more female oriented. I hope that it becomes more of a inclusive for everybody, but there's a lot of brands right now taking plastic bottles from the ocean that I don't know how they collect it, but they collect it and they turn it into a new material, which is cool. But also microplastics is like even bigger issue than like chunks of plastic, because there's so much microplastic in our water. Like, they're finding, basically, there's not a ton of research on it yet, but The research that is out there, they're like testing like stool and stuff, and there's pretty much everyone on earth is like full of plastic right now.
No way.
Yeah, from the top of my head, I don't really can think of any brands, but people are trying to do it now. It's like a trend to do cotton. What was the kind of cotton?
Organic cotton.
Organic cotton.
Yeah, but cotton has so much water. It's like 50 gallons of water per like pair of pants just to make it.
Wow.
That might even be really low. It might be, I don't know the numbers, but it's a lot of water because you have to water the plants and then like the production of making the pants, and then you have to send it like across the world usually to like get the pants from A to B. So by the time, like the footprint of one pair of pants is like insane. So yeah, there's brands that are remaking these like plastic, like these ones actually, the ones I'm wearing, they're girlfriend leggings. The female oriented, I don't know.
So it actually reminds me of the football team or the soccer team, Real Madrid.
Mm-hmm.
So their jerseys last year were actually recycled plastic. But now that you're saying that, that's even worse.
It's like, the problem is we need to have better laundry machines.
Ah, okay.
Because what happens is when we put the clothes that are made of plastic in the machine, then all the clothes start to like break up with like lint and stuff, and then the lint goes into our into our water system, and so then we have all this microplastic in the water. So either we need to get better washing machines, or we need to like put those plastic materials in a bag inside the washing machine.
That would be interesting.
But I think it's a tough issue. It's a very complex.
There seems to be more research also on it.
More research for sure, and more investment.
I think it would have to take one of the massive brands like Chanel or like Lululemon or Nike to really take charge of that, accountability of that.
Yes.
Imagine if we had a hand-me-down society, so instead of creating new fabrics, you just repurpose other fabrics to make new clothes, and because that brand is so powerful, they'll be able to sell it. You know what I mean? Like things like that.
Yes, listen out there, corporations.
Yeah. Well, they'll listen to you. You guys know what you're talking about, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah,
so what I've been trying to do, my new practices, is like if I see something that I like out there, I message the company and be like, I'm not going to purchase this until you make it more sustainable.
Okay.
So I'm boycotting.
Do you have a hashtag to go with that? Because if you don't, you definitely should create one.
I should create one.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that's the most powerful thing. I think people think that voting with their dollars towards purchasing an item is like good enough, but it's not. Like companies don't listen. Like what they care about is your money. So if you say like, I'll only buy this, but you have to do this first, they're gonna listen.
And if you go to a grocery store, and my mom taught me that a lot, when you go to a grocery store, you look at the shelves, and we just buy things that are without plastic wrapping. We could get potatoes in a plastic bag, and it's very handy and easy, and just come out of the store with it. Or we can just pick up potatoes in our own bag, and then not waste that plastic. And then eventually, if lots of people start doing that, then the brands will be like, I wonder why my things aren't selling. And then maybe they'll listen to this podcast and they'll know.
But you guys are right. That's how movements are literally made. This, you know, one small step at a time. And then because of the functionality of social media, now that can be, you know, captured.
Yeah, Emma talks about it a lot on her stories about plastic-free ideas and how to live your life that way.
To be completely honest, selfishly, I would totally want you guys to have a sustainability podcast just to educate people more, like myself, on it.
Mm-hmm.
So if people are purposefully searching how to do that, then listen to you guys, right?
Yeah.
And then obviously you could have a Pilates and dance one as well. But
yeah.
that goes without saying, but totally.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're interested in that.
Yeah, it's like literally taken me a lifetime to like start to like really sort this stuff out. And then moving to New York was like just an exponential challenge for that, because New York loves plastic. So true.
Especially if you look at the Hudson, you can see how much,
you cross the Hudson, you know.
That's how you got here.
Yeah.
But our class that we're having next week, Lululemon, it's called Sweat After Dark, And
you can sign up on Eventbrite. Eventbrite.
Anyway, it's in our LinkedIn bio. It's going to be a dance class. It's immersive. And so there's going to be, of course, there's going to be a little meditation at the beginning. And a little like rolling on the floor. It's open to all levels. You don't have to worry about like, oh my God, everyone's going to be in competition. No competition. It's like X rolls rolling on the floor, feeling really good in your body. And then we're going to break up into some like improv games.
Nice.
So it's just going to be pure fun.
And help people think critically and creatively.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we need that in our lives.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That's why we have this podcast, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that's next week, Thursday, 7:15 p.m.
At Lululemon Lab.
That sounds like so much fun.
You should come.
You should come.
When is it?
Next Thursday.
Thursday at?
Come. 7:15 p.m.
Okay.
We'll see you there.
And am I allowed to come over? Because I've never done Pilates before.
No,
it's
this
not
will
Pilates,
be dance.
It's dance.
Or dancing like that either.
Yeah, it's meant open line.
Alright.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Definitely allowed.
I'll come and show my dance skills and inspire some people.
Yeah, that's why we left it open at the end, because it sounded... We're like collaborating with the people at work who work at Lululemon Lab, and they're like, we just want to show off our moves. We're like, okay.
So I'm sure everyone has some moves in their sleeves they can show off.
Absolutely, I have a couple, so...
Yeah.
Bring your A-game, guys. All right, cool. It's Thursday. I'm marking it on my calendar.
Cool.
Mental note. 7, and then I'll just get the address from you guys, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. On Bond Street.
And you think they'll allow, like, people to record it, or, you know?
Yeah. It's very open. Mm-hmm. Hmm. If you want to record it, record yourself, record us, record other people. Definitely.
We're going to bring our stabilizer, I think.
We might bring that, yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Alright. Alright, so some of the benefits that people don't know about when they hear Pilates, they're like, oh, Pilates, you know, yoga, I'm used to going to the gym, da 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 da, I want to get brolic and diesel and all that. But Pilates adds a lot of functionality to the body, gets you nice and stretched and limber, right? Even makes you taller,
mm-hmm.
Yeah. But also adds some assistance in the bedroom category.
Yeah.
We're gonna be PG as possible, so.
Yeah. Why do I have to start with the bedroom category?
That's what we talked about.
Yeah, definitely it adds a lot to. Okay. Can I? Sex.
You can say it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna say sex. Yeah, definitely works very well. I can't even like warn you about it.
We're all 6 years old again. Yeah.
So like when your children.
Well, exactly. Think about it. There's a lot of position in yoga, like downward facing dog, upward facing dog, planks, which are also in Pilates, and then you work on the muscles that thrust, extend
with the core,
side,
right?
And yeah, so the core, and then once you have that strong core, you can be strong in bed.
Absolutely, because if you're not strong with your core, you're not doing something right. So
yeah.
Yeah.
And it's a lot of arm strength as well, if you think about it.
Yes.
And then so there's the serratus work, your lats and dorsi work, your whole spine, even lengthening your spine will help to get to positions that you might have not gotten before.
That's true.
Yes. There's a small muscle called the psoas minor.
Oh.
Do you know about the psoas?
I've heard of it. I just don't know where it is anatomically.
Okay, so it's a very deep muscle. It's the main muscle that connects your upper body to your lower body.
Sounds like a big deal.
It's a big deal.
for a small muscle, sounds like a big deal.
Yeah. Notice it. The psoas itself is a big muscle.
Okay.
It's a pretty big muscle. But there's a psoas minor. Only 40% of the population has it, and it helps in sex.
How do you know if you have it?
I don't know. You have to turn it die and then get your cadaver taken apart, and then you'll know.
I wonder if it's similar to the pineal gland. It's just people have it, they just don't use it.
They just don't use it?
Could it be like that?
I think they've done studies on cadavers, and like 40% of the cadavers have it.
40%. And I don't think you can test for it, right?
You don't want to think about dead bodies when you think about sex.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of weird.
If you don't have a dead body, you want to do Pilates and be active.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
but the psoas minor helps in sex. I don't know how, do you want to explain that? Because that's your expertise.
Psoas work?
No, psoas minor, because that's your action.
Unless you're on top, it's your action.
Okay, so...
So, it could be mutual actions at times.
Mutual, right? Yeah, it's true. What else does it help? You can get stronger orgasms with Pilates because you're constantly learning how to engage your pelvic floor. So,
or release.
Or release, so it's really important for the pelvic floor to operate both in a fully relaxed position and a fully engaged position. Just like any other muscle, you want it to be able to work through a full range. Same with the pelvic floor. I don't know if you're familiar with the pelvic floor, if you've heard like Kegels before.
Oh, I'm aware of Kegels and female ejaculation, all that, yes.
Yeah. So in Pilates, how you engage your core is not only your abdominal muscles, but also includes the top of the core, which is your diaphragm, and then the bottom of your core, which is the pelvic floor. And so every time you perform a Pilates exercise, you're engaging those muscles, and then you subsequently have to release them. So.
Is this where the concept of corgasm comes from?
Corgasm? I've never heard that.
The first one.
There's a book about it. You guys should definitely read it, because you'll definitely have a lot more insight than the average person reading it, and then you'll probably be able to break it down for laymans like us to be like, oh,
corgasm.
That's what that means. And you guys can add like a corgasm course for Pilates.
Have you read the book?
I have not. I just heard about it through like, you know, just research and whatnot.
Okay.
Yeah.
Also, just being able to stretch and like get into new positions. Flexibility is really important. Also, so many of the leg muscles are really deeply intertwined with the pelvic floor.
Right.
So being able to open up and stretch your legs is going to be really important in having more pleasurable experience.
And also using your legs.
And hip flexors too, right?
Mm-hmm. Hip flexors, which is your psoas.
Yeah. Oh!
Your psoas is a deep hip flexor.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense, because hips kind of connect to everything.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it moves the legs on top of your pelvis, or it moves the pelvis on top of your legs. So you can just imagine how you can use that.
It's true. A lot of fun ways to use that.
Yeah, lots of thrusting.
Yes. And different positions. So
absolutely.
Yeah, there's so many Pilates moves that people are like, I feel like I'm preparing for sex.
And you are.
Yeah. Like the carriage of the Pilates goes in and out constantly because you're pushing and pulling it. It's like it's very like sensual.
Right.
For a machine. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then I hear people make the same comparison with yoga as well. So it's kind of makes sense that Pilates would kind of fall into that
mm-hmm.
into that zone.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
A lot of Pilates is based off of yoga.
And then also the mental aspect, because a lot of people keep forgetting you can't, you know, there's no sex without the mind.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's literally no orgasm without mentally being able to actually do that.
Yeah, which goes back to the beginning when we were talking about meditation as well.
Absolutely.
When we start our classes, we meditate, we relax those muscles, and then you get a chance to contract and activate and then relax again at the end.
Right.
So you're constantly doing this repetitive movement. And with repetition, we get better.
It's true. And then I feel
it
like
lasts longer.
That's true. Also,
yes.
Kegels help as well.
Endurance. Pilates is all endurance.
That's a great point.
That is a good point.
Yeah.
You can last longer.
Mm-hmm.
From my research, I found that usually, I would say the majority of women, unfortunately, I wouldn't say in the world, but I would say majority in the United States have not experienced an orgasm before.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like a lot has to do with mental blocks.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know,
or maybe, just not being aware that it's happening.
That too.
Yeah.
Or kind of prevent it from happening as well.
Yeah.
Because unfortunately that kind of can happen.
Mm-hmm.
So Pilates kind of opens up everything.
Yeah.
So that's even more of an incentive to try it out.
A lot of your focus on your pelvis throughout class, like you have to be aware of those muscles. So,
yeah.
Certainly.
Yeah, both like pelvic stability, when you're passive, or pelvic mobility, when you're active, it works both ways.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So the moral of the story is, try Pilates, guys. You might like it.
You might like it.
And your partner might like it, too.
Yeah.
they might love it. So I gotta sell it. They're gonna love it.
Thanks, Josh.
Thank you. Mariusz.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Emma.
But the most important is that you remember Z moves.
Z moves. I love that.
So you guys, thanks for watching and listening.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
How do you say bye in Polish?
Cześć.
It sounds like ciao, a little bit.
Like ciao.
Like,
yeah, China.
Yeah.
Cute, yeah. Weird. That's all Europe.
Absolutely.
Pretty much blend of consonant
and
vowels.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, guys, it was great talking to you. Thank you for making the time. This is a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks for connecting. We basically connected, what, 2 days ago?
Exactly. On Bumble Biz. And for the people who are still using that function as the dating function, that's not how you do that.
It's a really great... This is how you do it.
Exactly. It's a really great way to network. And there's people on there, like these two lovely souls, who actually want to collaborate with other creative people. So it's a fun way to do that.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah,
and thank you. WeWorks and Rise by...
Yes, thank
Rise
you
by
so Lee. Much, WeWorks, for letting us use this beautiful space.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And Rise for booking it for us. And we'll see you in class.
Absolutely. Only child, high five. Nice.